Good afternoon and welcome. Hello, my name is Lauren Fisher, and I'm the Education Program Specialist with the U.S. Diplomacy Center at the U.S. Department of State. Welcome and thank you for joining us today. The U.S. Diplomacy Center is a museum and education center being built at the Department of State. Our exhibits and programs will tell the story of American diplomacy. What is diplomacy? Who are our diplomats? Why is diplomacy important to the American public? And in the spirit of what the U.S. Diplomacy Center will accomplish when we're open in 2017, we have been highlighting this month, February, the accomplishments of African Americans. We have highlighted the careers of famous African American diplomats on our social media feeds and posts, and we continue that conversation today in this Google Hangout. And in doing so, we've invited some friends and colleagues with us to join the conversation. Dr. Carlton McLellan of the Association for Diplomatic Studies and Training, Christopher Teal, who serves as the Consul General in our United States Consulate in Nogales, Mexico, and Monty McGee, Foreign Service Officer working in the Bureau of Economic Affairs. So welcome to you all today, and welcome to all of you, our viewers. We would like to create a conversation today. We would like to hear from you, so please remember to tweet us your questions at Diplomacy Center or post your questions on our Facebook post, which is U.S. Diplomacy Center. So with that, I would like our panelists to offer an introduction of themselves, and I would like to start with Dr. Carlton McLellan, Senior Fellow at the Association for Diplomatics and Studies and Training, where he leads the Bunche Legacy Project. Welcome, Carlton.
Thank you, Lauren. Good afternoon, everybody. Again, my name is Carlton McLellan. Very happy to be here with you all this afternoon, and happy Black History Month as we near the end of Black History Month. As Lauren mentioned, my name is Carlton. I'm a senior fellow at ADST, which is the Association for Diplomatic Studies and Training. I am responsible for what's called the Bunche Legacy Project, which basically does some similar to what we're doing here today, but it's a deep dive into the history and contributions of African Americans to the U.S. diplomatic and foreign affairs process. So we follow in the legacy of the namesake Dr. Ralph Bunche, who was the first African American to win the Nobel Peace Prize and an avid diplomat himself. So that's my responsibility there at ADST. I should mention also that I am not a Foreign Service officer. I'm a civilian, if you will. So my work at ADST is as a researcher. But my other hat that I wear today, I'm also a managing director at Global Ties US, which is a network of citizen diplomacy organizations across the country. So I wear both hats today, and I'm, again, happy to be with you all today, and I'm looking forward to speaking with you about a subject near and dear to my heart. So thank you.
And we look forward to what you have to say. So thank you so much, Carlton. Christopher Teal, welcome. Thank you. And I forgot to mention in the introduction that you have been, or you are the author of the book, Hero of Española, America's First Black Diplomat, Ebenezer Bassett. So we are so happy to have you here today to share about your book. So I now toss it to you to offer a brief intro on yourself.
Great. Thanks. Thanks very much, Lauren. It's a real pleasure to be here, participate with Diplomacy Center, and to be on this distinguished panel with some colleagues interested not only in diplomacy, but I think the important legacy of African Americans in U.S. history more broadly. Just a little bit about myself. You know, I've been a Foreign Service officer for the last 17 years. Currently, I'm working as the Consul General in Nogales, Mexico, which is here on the Sonora-Arizona border. I really began my career, in fact, working as a Foreign Service officer on my first assignment back in Santo Domingo, Dominican Republic. And in fact, I'm glad you mentioned Bassett in the book, because that's where I really began to know the Bassett story and drew a lot of interest in Ebenezer Bassett and to begin to think more about his legacy. And I've had the pleasure, really, of serving most of my career as a CONED public diplomacy officer. And so what does that mean for a lot of people who maybe aren't familiar with the Foreign Service? You know, those of us who work in the Department of State as Foreign Service officers, we have specializations, so you can work as a political or economic or management or public diplomacy officer in my case. And so I've been in charge of media relations, working on exchanges, working on English language programming, cultural programming, speakers, events, you name it. I've really had an opportunity to do a kind of a wide range of outreach, really presenting a public face and interacting with the public at large throughout my various assignments. Aside from working in Santo Domingo, I had the chance to work in Lima, Peru, where I was cultural affairs officer. I did a couple of assignments back in Washington at the State Department, working in the European Bureau and working for the Foreign Press Center. From there, I went to work at our consulate in Guadalajara, Mexico. And my assignment right before coming here to Nogales, I was head of our public affairs office for our embassy in Colombo, Sri Lanka. So I've specialized mostly in Latin America, but I have had a chance to really talk about and work on issues all across the globe. Here in Nogales, I really kind of deal with a broad range of issues overseeing our consulate, whether it's the political, the economic, the security, the public affairs as well. And so it's really been a pleasure to be back in Mexico, and particularly be back on the border where there's so much activity going on between the U.S. And our neighbor to the south. So thank you again, Lauren. Thank you for the opportunity to speak, particularly about Ebenezer Bassett.
Wonderful, and thank you for that excellent overview in terms of the State Department and the jobs that our foreign service officers do here, because there are many and they are diverse, and to, again, sort of help us learn a little bit more about what foreign service officers do is Monty McGee, who is a foreign service officer, a public affairs officer working here, posted currently in D.C. in our Economic Affairs Bureau. Welcome, Monty.
Well, thank you, and good afternoon. Thank you, Lauren, and I'm really pleased to be a part of such a distinguished panel as well. I am a third tour officer working here in Washington in the Economic Bureau, where I focus on commercial business and trade issues as well as entrepreneurship. And I'm most recently returned from Guatemala, where I served as a consular officer. And one of the things that I'm really interested in and was so pleased to be a part of this panel, because I, as a newer officer, I know Chris has been in for many, many years and served a distinguished career, but as a newer officer, I'm really excited to learn about those that have come before me and learn about what I can offer through my service as well. And so, again, I'm just excited to be a part of this panel and looking forward to a very fun and robust discussion.
Excellent. Thank you. So to our viewers, remember, please tweet your questions to @DiplomacyCenter or post them on our Facebook page, U.S. Diplomacy Center. And actually, Monty, our first question is for you. So if you could tell us an experience that you've had as a Foreign Service officer where being an African American made a difference.
Sure. Thank you for the question, Lauren. I've had a wonderful time as a Foreign Service officer, and much of that has been defined by me representing all of the great things that that our country has to offer. But there have been experiences as well that gave me the opportunity to highlight the cultural background from which I come. And one of the things that immediately comes to mind is before actually joining the department, I was an intern in our embassy, or mission rather, in Taipei. And traveling around Taiwan and also traveling through Southwest China before joining, I learned that there was a unique interest in my cultural background that opened up many doors for me to engage with the local population. And then most recently, when I was working in Guatemala, I did an outreach program that focused on the history of hip-hop culture in America. And I presented to middle school children, and it was just an amazing time to really share some of the artistic history that African Americans have contributed to and expose communities that have never heard of those things abroad. So,
excellent. indeed, that must have made you feel very proud to be able to share some of those experiences with those audiences. Thank you for sharing that. And so, Chris, as we sort of pull out and look at a little bit more of at history and a historical figure, as you've studied Ebenezer Bassett, perhaps you could shed some light for our listeners today on the legacy of Bassett, but also how did his being of African descent influenced what happened with his career, or specifically in Hispaniola when he was there?
Yeah, sure. That's an interesting point. And in fact, you know, Ebenezer Bassett really was an extraordinary person, not just breaking the color barrier as the first African American diplomat, but really his life even before that. He was a real trailblazer in so many ways. In the pre-Civil War era in the United States, and then in the post-Civil War era as well. And quite frankly, unfortunately, he had really largely been lost to history. He had been almost a forgotten character. I stumbled across the Bassett story, as I mentioned, in my first assignment in Santo Domingo. You know, most of our embassies and consolates, we've got, there's a wall that leads to the ambassador's office with the predecessors, the former ambassadors and chiefs of mission that lined that wall. And as I walked down to the ambassador's office during my first few days there in country, I saw a number of faces of individuals who had served as ambassador to Haiti and the Dominican Republic. They were accredited to both sides of Hispaniola. And I recognized Frederick Douglass's face, and I was surprised that he had served as our minister resident, as they were called then, or chief of mission at the embassy. But then I looked back and I saw Ebenezer Bassett, and I was surprised. And I tried to do a little more research and look up more information about him, and frankly, I could not find a lot. There had been a little bit written, but he was, as I said, largely forgotten and lost to history. And so that was something I really spurred my interest. And when I realized, in fact, he was the first African-American nominated to serve as a diplomat, this came right at a very crucial time in U.S. history, right prior to the Civil War. President Ulysses S. Grant was newly in office, and part of the mandate that he had was really to send a message to the world, but also domestically within the United States, that we were going to fully integrate African-Americans into our political life, and that included our diplomatic life overseas. And so he was nominated by President Grant to serve in Haiti and the Dominican Republic, which obviously have an interesting integrated relationship with the United States, a very complicated one over many centuries, complicated issues from the colonial period and the post-colonial period. But that really was sending a message, I think, to the people of Haiti and the Dominican Republic. And so race played a crucial role. But it's important to know Bassett really wasn't nominated strictly because he happened to be a black man in the United States. He really had this incredibly strong track record as an educator, as an abolitionist, and really as quite honestly, once he got into that role of diplomat there in Haiti and the Dominican Republic, as really a courageous leader. And I think that's really a great message for us today in the modern Foreign Service, to think about, you know, the difficulties and the often complicated situations that we all have to deal with out here in the field or even back there in Washington, a lot of the difficult issues we grapple with. And it does take courage. It does take leadership. It does take some willingness to push some boundaries and push some issues and take some risks. And we see that time and time again in diplomacy. And he was really an early trailblazer in so, so many ways.
Excellent. Excellent. Thank you so much. And Carlton, I would imagine that as you have researched the contributions of African-American U.S. ambassador and diplomats as widely as you have found lots of examples of this too. And perhaps you could share with us today some of the legacy of those diplomats and the impact that they have had on our modern Foreign Service.
Absolutely. I think Chris made some excellent points in terms of what it's taken to be, in general, a leader when it comes to our diplomatic relations, particularly as I look in my research, as I look specifically at the role of the African-American who has been a U.S. ambassador. I see that across the spectrum in their different roles and experiences that they've had prior to becoming ambassadors, so, you know, as part of their either their foreign service role, or for those who are what's called non-career or political appointees, those who have not come through the foreign service. So it's been a very interesting group of again, I think, leaders. I think of one of my favorite stories is Ambassador Pierre Richard Prosper, who was a recent ambassador at large for war crimes. And you look at his background prior to becoming an ambassador in 2001. He was an attorney, and many people who grew up in my time and age in the 80s and 90s will remember the movie Boys in the Hood, that really showed the gang violence and the dangers in Los Angeles, California. Ambassador Prosper in real life time in Los Angeles was one of the assistant attorneys there in Los Angeles, responsible for prosecuting the crimes that were happening, the violent crimes that were happening during that time. He went from there to take a real keen interest in what was going on in Rwanda. And so this, you know, that he took that violent, his role in legal, leading in the legal areas and domestically overseas to take an interest in Rwanda and what was happening with the Rwandan genocide. And long story short there, he used that experience and ultimately became a trial attorney, one of two trial attorneys responsible for prosecuting the crimes, the war crimes of the Rwandan genocide war criminals. And even more importantly, in terms of his leadership there, he and his fellow prosecutor were for the first time in the history of international human rights got rape classified as a war crime. And as such, these criminals who were responsible for sexual violence during the genocide were prosecuted for war crimes. So the point I make there is, in terms of the leadership of our African-American diplomats, again, whether they come from the ranks of the career diplomacy foreign service or whether they come from other disciplines, these individuals have shown extreme leadership in their respective fields of endeavor. And I think that legacy is, that should show to our current diplomats or those who are interested in diplomacy, that regardless of what your professional interest is, whether you're an attorney or a doctor or an engineer, regardless, diplomacy, there is a role for all of us to play, whatever those professional interests are. And so that, for me, is just one great example from Ambassador Prosper of that.
Indeed, and an excellent example to show how, coming from his experience, he was really able to bring to bear his contributions in the situation with Rwanda. So actually, Monty, we have a question for you from our Facebook that says, do you have someone that you have looked to as a model for inspiration as you kind of enrich your career as a foreign service officer, Monty?
Well, yes, definitely. There are numerous individuals within the current ranks that I look to as examples. Our Assistant Secretary for African Affairs, for example, Linda Thomas Greenfield, and the amazing work that she's done throughout her career, and her work throughout the continent of Africa is truly inspiring, as well as that of retired Ambassador Johnny Young, who just recently I had the pleasure of meeting. And learning more from him about his career, and the list goes on. Ambassador Perkins and Stanfield, and I think kind of outside of the ranks of the department, there are other individuals that I've learned a great deal from in their writings, but also in just learning about their lives. Our civil rights leaders, those that have written about not only the struggle, but the achievements and accomplishments of African Americans in the U.S. Those stories and those examples are ones that I take with me when I'm abroad, but also that I try to work into every aspect of what I do here in Washington.
Great, and you mentioned, Monty, in your opening remarks that you were interested, in fact, learning more about Ebenezer Bassett. So, Chris, why do you think that the story of Bassett is, and his accomplishments are unknown to most Americans?
Well, I do think it was unfortunate, you know, serving at such a crucial time, post-Civil War time in the United States, a time of America sort of stepping onto the world stage internationally, in such a tremendous way, and a lot of changes going on. He was certainly a crucial player for all of that. And Honduras tried in Lima as well. I just became very frustrated. When I moved back to Washington to work at the department, I found an incredible a series of resources that were available, both at the National Archives, Library of Congress. I reached out to a lot of historians, historical societies in different parts of the United States. And as I began reading more and more information about all the struggles that he had to deal with, I mean, this was a man who arrived at Haiti in the midst of a civil war. He had to deal with civil wars, coup d'etats. He had to deal with earthquakes, fires, famine, feasts, plagues, etc., a whole variety of issues. And it was just a fascinating story, and I thought, oh my gosh, somebody's got to really tell this. This man accomplished so much, and it's so unfortunate that a broader public hasn't heard about it. But particularly for those of us currently working in the Foreign Service, this is the kind of individual that you look back to as really a role model in so many different ways. And so I just sort of took it upon myself to begin to do a little bit of writing. I had the pleasure of working earlier, before I joined the Foreign Service, on a biography about Thurgood Marshall with a journalist, well-known journalist Juan Williams. So I'd had a little bit of an idea to how to put a book together, but I really hadn't done it. I'm not a professional historian. So it's really a mixture of sort of an historical perspective, a biography, but also really about diplomacy. And I think that's kind of the value added that I bring to the table with it, because of his courageousness, because of his ability to make difficult decisions. I mean, one of the great stories out of a chapter of his time in Port-au-Prince was during one of the many basically uprisings against the government there, a few of the former military leaders came to Bassett's house, to his residence, and asked for asylum, asked for protection. They were being hunted down by the army, and so he took them in. Even though taking asylees really wasn't Department of State policy, it was kind of frowned upon. From a humanitarian perspective, he decided to take them in and really began to negotiate with the Haitian government for their eventual release to safety. But that was a 5 or 6 month siege of his house. I mean, the military surrounded his house; they did not let him leave. I just imagine me in my current situation as Consul General being surrounded and you know, not letting people in or out, and it would have made things extraordinarily difficult. You've also got to remember at the time that he served, this was the time before the internet, this was the time before radio, telephone, even the telegraph. I mean, literally, Ebenezer Bassett was handwriting his correspondence, his cables, back to Washington. It would go on a boat and then go up to the United States. So traffic didn't move very quickly, and he had to sort of think on his feet and take a lot of responsibility and action. And you know, that's something we're constantly checking back in with Washington or the embassy to sort of move ahead. But these are good guidelines. I mean, we're put here in these positions and expected to lead and do the job that we need to do for our country. And he did just that under extremely difficult circumstances.
I actually remember that part of the book, and it was quite compelling because you really brought to life his moment of indecision of what to do with that, whether to accept them into his house or not. So wonderful. And I would imagine, Dr. McLellan, that you in your research have found lots of examples of those diplomats who have exhibited incredible courage. So A, would you like to share one of your favorite ones on that? But B, also share for our viewers how they may access some of these stories and some of these researchers, especially sort of the research that you're involved with.
Absolutely. Thanks, Lauren. Start with B, the accessing of information. Wonderful, wonderful resource on the ADST website, www.adst.org, called the Foreign Affairs Oral Histories. This is a collection of over 1,900 interview transcripts with diplomats of all sizes, shapes, colors over the last 30 years. These oral histories are in these diplomats' own words. They're long, some of them are very long, 300 pages, but they're candid conversations with America's diplomats about their work, about their legacies, about their lives, about the challenges that they've faced, about the accomplishments that they've had. So these oral histories are just an excellent way for you to really get into the minds of American diplomats. Within that collection are several that we're currently still getting onto the site. Of the first 10 African-American diplomats, or I'm sorry, African-American ambassadors. The first African-American ambassador with the title and rank of ambassador was Edward Dudley in 1949. And so from Dudley to the first 10, their oral history, someone has sat down with them prior to their passing and had conversations about their experiences as diplomats. And it just tells, again, wonderful stories from their own lips. So that's where you can go to get some great resources. What I would say then toward the second question, stories of that courage and stories of that leadership. One story, so this one isn't on the site yet. It's interviews that I've actually been having with one of our ambassadors, Ambassador June Carter Perry, who served both in Lesotho as well as our ambassador to Sierra Leone. But Ambassador Perry tells a really interesting story about the time when she was, prior to becoming ambassador, when she was what was called the Deputy Chief of Mission. So my Foreign Service officer colleagues will, I think, let me know that is the second in charge, essentially, at a U.S. embassy. Ambassador Perry actually was the Deputy Chief of Mission to another African-American ambassador, Ambassador Mosina Cook, Mosina Jordan, in the Central African Republic. Which, as a side, we think that was probably one of the rare cases where there was two African American women responsible in the first and second positions at a U.S. embassy. Again, an amazing fact, I believe. But Ambassador Perry just tells a story about the time in Central African Republic, mid-90s. There were several military mutinies there in Central African Republic, and she and Ambassador Jordan and the rest of the team were really responsible for helping to cull the violence that was happening. There was a lot going on in terms of needing to evacuate American citizens, both embassy personnel as well as Peace Corps personnel and other citizens. And so she tells the story about, the interesting part to everybody is hearing war stories, hearing about bombs exploding behind you and gunshots overhead and those sorts of things. And she tells those stories while they're working at the embassy, having to jump on the floor, all those things that happen during this military violence. But for me, the most interesting part of that story is as she talks about the evacuation process. And the needs to work closely with other countries, the French at that time, the Germans. They brought together six different African heads of state to talk about how do they all work together to help the president of Central African Republic at that time call the violence in the country. So one, for me, that's an interesting story because it tells the story of how our diplomats don't only work on issues related to the country that they're in. So you're in Central African Republic. Your role isn't, from what I read in this, your role is not just to work on U.S. Central African Republic relations. You are helping develop and establish relations with other countries that are in that particular country. You're building relations in that instance with the French, with the Germans, with other African countries. So it's a very interesting, for me, it was as a researcher very interesting to read that. And as I talk with other ambassadors, I hear that story more and more, that those relationships are being built with multiple countries even when you're based in one country. And I really think that's an interesting way, for interesting story, and really interesting for other researchers and those interested in this topic to delve into it more deeply and see what happens with those relationships that are built in country. So that's the reason why I think, for me, that was such an interesting story, because it told a story of more than just dealing with a crisis. The other part of that that's really interesting is those evacuation criteria, what they did during that evacuation process, they had to make some adjustments to whatever the normal protocol is with evacuations, which I understand all of our embassies have some sort of evacuation plan. Some adjustments along the way because of the situation on the ground. She had to make key decisions, leadership decisions, about what to do. And after all of that was done, they got everyone evacuated okay. Turns out later on, those same evacuation criteria were sort of infused into the training of the Foreign Service officers at the Foreign Service Institute. So they used her experiences and what she was doing, leading the way in terms of getting Americans out safely became part of training, new training opportunities for future Foreign Service officers. So again, I think Ambassador Perry's leadership in that instance, her as well as Ambassador Jordan, I think is one of those stories that I really picked out from my research.
Excellent. And I'm really getting the sense that the research that you're conducting by our participants taking it upon themselves to read some of it, really get a sense of not only the climate of a given country or what's happening in a particular territory, as well as learning about the biography of a particular diplomat and the kind of leadership that they're bringing into their job. And just to, a note to our participants, we will make sure that we include links to those resources that Dr. McLellan has mentioned on our Google page. So when you come back, we will make sure we will include those links so you can access that, as well as, again, the title of the book on Ebenezer Bassett. So we have time for two more questions, and this one, the first of those that has come into us from Facebook. There are many issues that demand the time and attention of African-American students today. What is the best reason for an African-American in school now to consider a career in diplomacy? And perhaps, Monty, do you want to take that first, and we'll let the others answer as well?
Sure, thank you. I think that's a great question. I just recently sat on a panel where we spoke to a group of some 200 African-American students representing historically black colleges and universities across the country. I myself am an alumni of an HBCU, Norfolk State University in Norfolk, Virginia. And at that time, while still studying in undergrad, there was an exchange student from Nigeria who was teaching, and he came into one of the classrooms that I was a part of and talked to us about learning about the world outside of our borders and experiencing things that we may be the only person in our family to experience. And he wrote his name on the whiteboard, and then he walked out and he said, you know, if anybody's interested, contact me. And I think I might have been the only or one of the few that followed up with him, because that type of opportunity truly intrigued me. And I think that intrigues a lot of students as well. And I ended up studying abroad in China, and that kind of set me on this path to becoming a Foreign Service officer, and had a lot of great opportunities in between. But I think students, regardless their background, will be really interested to learn about the unique opportunities that a career in the Foreign Service offers, whether it be based on, you know, representing your country and the personal pride that in and of itself has, or traveling and learning languages all around the world and engaging with communities that are eager many times to learn about, you know, the unique background that you bring to this work. Those things are not only drivers to why I'm a Foreign Service officer today, but I think that those things are kind of what keep me inspired to continue in this role. And I think that students of all kinds will really be receptive to that message. And I look forward to the opportunity to have people continue to cover those messages as the two my colleagues are doing today.
Excellent. Thank you. Chris or Carlton, do you care to offer a response to that? Why should African Americans consider a career in diplomacy?
Sure.
Yeah, Carlton.
Sure. Just following up on Monty's comments, which I think were spot on. And I would frame the question in terms of why should African Americans be interested in international affairs more broadly. I gave an example recently when I was giving a presentation on being back in my hometown, a little small town called Lima, Ohio. and I was talking to a group of kids, and this was in 2011, just after one of the earthquakes in Japan, and I've got many, many family members who work at the local Honda plant that's not too far away from my hometown, and I said to those kids, well, how many of you have parents who work at Honda? Half the room raised their hand. How many of your parents didn't go to work last week? That same group raised their hand, and I asked them, well, do you know why? And they just said the plant was shut down. So then we had an interesting conversation about why the Honda plant had shut down for a few days after the earthquake happened in Japan. And I was really just trying to illustrate to them that although you're in this very small town, who some of you have never even heard of Japan, here's how what's happening in another country impacts you directly. So we just ended up having a really good, candid conversation about why that's important. So I say to any young African-American or any young students in general, of course, we're in this day and age where you have to, you're not sitting in your house without things on the outside impacting you. You read in the news every day things going on globally, and you hear like that earthquake. You might not know it's impacting your daily life and your parents' daily life, but it is. So because of that, it's very important for you to have just some general understanding of what and how these things are impacting your life. So for me, that's the reason that it's important. As Monty also said, there are just so many experiences that you're not going to get if you don't sort of broaden your horizon and learn about other places and other countries and other cultures. And in my 9-to-5 job at Global Ties US, part of what we're doing is that very thing. We're trying to make sure all the citizens of this country, particularly, understand that they have not just a responsibility, but also a right to sort of be engaged with our country's diplomatic relations. So they're on a constant basis interacting with foreign participants who are coming to the United States. Chris mentioned he'd work with our embassy's exchange programs. We work with those State Department exchange programs and really try and get Americans of all shapes and sizes and colors and economic backgrounds interested in engaging with other people from other countries. Because we, as I believe our colleagues at the State Department believe, that's how our country is going to, one, make friends, two, be able to continue to carry out the business of having strong relations with other countries. So for me, it's very important for young people of all colors to understand that.
Excellent. That was great. And I particularly liked your example of visiting your hometown in Lima, Ohio, and helping those young people understand how international relations or diplomacy impacts them. And just to add that is in part why we are building the U.S. Diplomacy Center here in Washington, D.C., a part of the State Department. The U.S. Diplomacy Center will open at the end of 2017, and that's exactly what we aim to do. We helped to illustrate for the U.S. citizen how diplomacy impacts them. And to Chris, just to pull you in on that conversation, should African Americans in school consider a career in diplomacy? Is it in our interest? Is it in the government's interest to have a diverse workforce?
Well, absolutely. I think it's vital. You know, as the department, we want to have diversity, whether it's racial diversity, ethnic diversity, religious diversity. We want to have gender balance. We want to represent the United States in as broad and diverse way as possible. We are absolutely engaging with a variety of audiences in any given country, and there's often diversity in those countries. And so it's incumbent upon us to recruit and train and bring into leadership positions people from all sorts of backgrounds. Plus, I think it just makes good sense. I think it makes good sense to bring new ideas, bring new voices to the table, bring different voices to the table, whether it's us internally discussing issues, to hear from different perspectives, or whether we're presenting an argument to a foreign government or to a foreign public, discussing, you know, the importance of that diversity, discussing the importance of respecting fundamentals of, religious freedoms, of sexual freedoms, etc., because often we're having to deal with governments in many parts of the world that don't necessarily view human rights in the same way that we do. And so it helps, it honestly helps if you can visually have people making these arguments of different backgrounds, you know, that you have that variety. So I think it makes an excellent recruiting tool for us to really help and reach out, and I think it makes a lot of sense from our policy perspectives, too.
Yeah, excellent. So we have time for one final question, which is coming from Facebook in our last 5 minutes, and it's a big question, but it's posed to all of you. We should remember that African-American contributions have not always been honored. What have been some of the milestones or turning points that have advanced the inclusion of African-Americans in U.S. diplomacy? Carlton?
Great question. I mean, I can't name them chronologically, of course, but a few I think that are important. One, as I mentioned in my first remarks, Ralph Bunche, I think when he received the Nobel Peace Prize, 1951, I believe, if I got the date right, very, very important milestone. I think the naming of Ambassador Dudley as our first ambassador in 1949, another important milestone to remember. I think, so those I think are two of the big ones for me. Let me think about a couple more and give my colleagues a chance to talk about a couple as well.
And I'll also add that on state.gov, we have a historian's website that highlights some of these. And so at the conclusion of our talk today, we will make sure that those are posted and that our viewers today can have easy access to some of those ideas. Chris, is there anything you want to add there?
Yeah, sure. No, I think, you know, starting with Bassett in 1886, you had a series of our chief of mission serving there in Haiti and the Dominican Republic. Eventually, you did in Liberia as well later on in the 19th century. You know, honestly, quite often our diplomatic engagement with African-American ambassadors, with chief of missions, was geared toward countries that were largely racially black. And I think that radically began to change, obviously, in the 20th century. You had, individuals that were appointed through Europe, through Latin America, through the rest of the world, as should be reflected in our society. But that was a slow, gradual process, quite honestly. I mean, I think it was, you know, part of our history, part of our cultural dialogue is really kind of that post-Civil War Reconstruction period, and then I think a little bit of falling back during a lot of the Jim Crow period. But then you had the sort of the desegregation movement that took place in the 40s, 50s, and 60s. And so that really opened up a lot, I think, politically, internationally as well. And then you saw a great number of ambassadors begin to move forward, both men and women, of a variety of backgrounds and taking on leadership roles and really being fully brought to the table.
Certainly a very rich history. Monty, is there anything you would want to add in?
Right. I'm not a historian myself, but one of the stories that has been really inspiring for me is that of Ambassador Edward Perkins and his experience, being an ambassador to U.S. ambassadors to South Africa during a very tumultuous period of apartheid and representing our nation in one of the most difficult situations. Hearing him talk about himself, one of the most difficult situations that he had experienced, but doing it with a level of dignity and honor that it was truly, hearing it from him was truly inspiring for me to know that he had to endure some of those struggles, but still was able to be, you know, an amazing professional in presenting, you know, the U.S. foreign policy initiatives that were set forth.
Excellent. Thank you for that. And actually, it should not go unacknowledged that there was the recent passing of Ambassador John Reinhardt, who served as the Assistant Secretary of Public Affairs under Secretary of State Henry Kissinger, and the first and only African-American to serve in that role still. He was also the first career diplomat to head USIA and oversaw ECA's move from the State Department to USIA during the 1970s. And so we acknowledge his passing. He was 95. And his photo is, in fact, in the hall of the public affairs where he served as secretary. So, but I'm so glad you brought up Ralph Bunche and Edward Perkins, and we'll make sure we have links to their biographies on our Google Hangout page so our participants can learn more about those diplomats and their service to the State Department. I again want to bring to the attention to our participants the hero of Hispaniola, America's first black diplomat, Ebenezer D. Bassett, by our panelist today, Chris Teal. So thank you all so much. And just a word to our participants, more Google Hangouts are coming. I appreciate so much the conversation that we've had here today. It is very much in keeping with who the U.S. Diplomacy Center is and the kinds of programs that we will host in our new facility once we open up the State Department at the end of 2017. So stay tuned. Thank you so much. Be sure to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at Diplomacy Center. And we will see you all soon. Thank you.